Okay, let's get going. People at home, can you see me and hear me all right?
Yes.
Excellent. Thank you, Rodrigo, Miguel, Jorge. All right. Okay, so yesterday we got started with section two. And as we discussed, it's going to be about electrostatics in vacuum. Most of it you already know, so just take this section as an opportunity to practice things like your math skills, right? I mean, we'll do exercises and do integrals in whatever two dimensions, is fine. Reflect a bit on the concepts of gradient, divergence, rotational, all these things we'll use. Okay. The only actual, really, really new thing is the end of the section, which is the multiple expansion of the potential. So this whole beginning can be slow at times. I don't know, but just take this time to make sure that you have the base real well settled. Because when we go into other sections, like three, when we put matter or magnetostatics, magnetostatics. Be it in vacuum or in the presence of matter, we'll go fast and give all these concepts pretty much for granted. Okay, so bear with me, even if you think I'm going a bit slow for now. So what were we doing yesterday, and what are we going to do today? Yesterday we just did talk about general concepts like charge or current. Okay, concepts that we will need to go over and understand because we're going to use them. We left it talking about electric current, which, as we discussed, is not a part of electrostatics, but whatever. Since we are at basic concepts, let's make sure that everybody's in the same page regarding current. And we did talk about the current density. Which is a concept related to electric intensity, the one that you know, right, from basic, just basic electrostatics or magnetostatics. And this is the number of current lines. It's a vector field. How much charge per unit volume is moving at what speed? This is, by the way, the very same current density that you probably used last year, but you wrote it in a somewhat, maybe slightly different way, which is number of carriers per unit volume times the charge of one current, the charge of one carrier, one electron, for example. This is the current, the charge density. Number of particles per unit volume times the charge of one particle. This is total charge per unit volume times velocity. It's the same thing. This is current density. And we did also come to the realization that what we have in the past named intensity, for example, when talking about current across straight wires and the Ohm's law and all of those things that you know very well, is just a flux. The number of current density lines going through a given surface S, which can be perpendicular to the transport, or it can be at whatever any angle. This is basically what we discussed today. One more thing, which is important about charge, that you also know, is that charge is conserved. There is the law of charge conservation, yeah, right? Share screen, window, this window. Okay. This meeting is being recorded, fine. Okay, you know that in nature, in processes where, at least in processes where there are no particles destroyed or created, obviously the total charge has to be conserved, right? Since electric charge is conserved for all known processes, for most known processes, if you have whatever, some particle accelerator, you are at CERN or something, yeah, you can actually destroy particles by, you know, having them clash against each other and such. But anyhow, these are special processes. For our processes, charge is going to be preserved. Okay, and so then the only way that we can actually change the amount of net charge in a given region or body in space is just putting charge in or taking it out. That's the only way. Okay, so by definition, by changing, putting charge in or out of a system, what we are doing is basically putting an intensity of current into the system or taking it out. And you know that the electric intensity, you know what, II, is defined as the amount of charge per unit time flowing through a given position, whatever, at a point in space. Imagine there was some charge flowing here, and I'm an observer, and I am measuring 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10, whatever, 50 electrons in 10 seconds. That's what we call, 50 times 1.6 to the minus 19 coulombs over 50. Whatever that was the result, that would be amperes. The amperes, the whatever x amperes flowing, right? This is a definition of charge intensity that you know. But then, it also can be written, as we have said, as the flux, the net number of current density lines going through the surface of whatever the section, for example, of the electric wire that I am measuring. Okay, and using the Gauss theorem, and by the Gauss theorem I mean the mathematical Gauss theorem, the flux of a given quantity across a surface S is identically equal to the volume integral of the divergence of that thing, calculated within the volume defined by the surface. Right. This is the Gauss theorem that you have seen last week with Norbert, I very much hope. Okay, let's leave it there. The intensity can be written, the intensity flowing through some volume in space can be written as the integral of the divergence of change, whatever that might mean. Let's stop there. We're again thinking of how to change the amount of charge in a fixed volume, in a finite volume in space. And we have said it can only be changed by putting charge in or taking charge out. What is the intensity that has to flow into or out of the volume? This is how we can calculate it. Provided we know J, of course. Okay, let's leave it there. But then we can take a different view. Go inside the volume. Now I'm a tiny observer inside my volume of interest, but I just count how many particles, in other words, how much charge, are going in or out. Okay? If I count particles going out or particles going in per unit time, and I calculate, again, the amount of charge per unit time, with one little, just one small, but actually very big, physically speaking, a detail in mind. And it's, when we calculate fluxes across a surface, for example, imagine a sphere or something easy if you want to, our surface vector, which is something you probably know, but I don't think I said this yesterday, is the normal vector in every point that points outwards, okay? In other words, this quantity, this scale, this scalar product, this dot product, will be positive when vector J and the surface vector in every point are more or less parallel, or at this point more or less in the same direction. In other words, if the current density is flowing outwards, this will be positive, mathematically speaking. If the current density is flowing inwards, then J and DS go opposite, and then I will have a minus sign coming out of the cosine in this product. So this quantity, just the way I define it here, is positive when electric particle, I mean current or charged particles flow out of my volume, and it's negative when things flow in, just because, again, the surface vector is defined pointing outwards by definition. We need to define it somehow. Just get a definition, stick to it, and be consistent. For us, surface vectors point outwards, period. Now, if I actually change or change my mindset and I go into the surface and I see how much charge is going in or out by just measuring the amount of net charge in the surface, what I was doing in my second approach to the problem, when charge goes out, I will see charge decreasing. When charge comes in, I'll see the net charge increasing. In other words, the derivative of charge with respect to time will be, in my new frame of reference, positive when current flows in, negative when it flows out. In order to actually measure the amount of charge leaving, for example, my volume, and for this definition to be somehow consistent with that one, I need to define as negative, because I want to, or positive if you want to, but I need to put a minus sign in between. If I want to convey the idea that when charge increases, life is negative. Charge increases means charge is coming. Then things are negative for me. And when charge decreases, in other words, that would be a negative derivative with Q with respect to time, but then charge leaves. For me, this is good. In other words, positive. So if I put a minus in front of this derivative and I calculate the net amount of charge, I mean, the increase or decrease of net charge inside the surface, and I put just a minus here, what I will measure is the net increase or decrease of charge with a negative, and negative result will mean charge coming in, positive is coming out. So this minus is just a way of making sure that a decrease of net charge means physically that charge is leaving, and an increase of net charge inside means that charge is coming in. Okay? So is in this respect, this minus sign I put in here is just like a thermodynamic sign, just to make sure that if I make work, then energy increases, or if I take work out of a system, it decreases, this sort of idea. So anyhow, if I just calculate minus the total, the net change of charge in my surface, within my volume with respect to time, in other words, the net charge, the net got change over time. Obviously, the total charge within my volume, as we discussed yesterday, is the integral of the charge density inside, right? Calculated in the whole volume. Q is this thing. So minus the derivative of Q with respect to time is minus the derivative with respect to time of this integral. Okay? Now, this integral is calculated with respect to spatial variables, x, y, z, or r, theta, phi, or whatever system of coordinates you want to use, but it's, again, space. And this is a derivative with respect to time. This means that this derivative and this integral commute. You can either first do the integral and then do the derivative, or first do the derivative and then do the integral of the result. So I can put the derivative inside the integral. It can go in and out. They are independent. They work on different variables. So I put the derivative inside the integral. However, in the moment I put this thing into there, I'm going to write as a partial derivative with respect to time, which is only a way of not forgetting the fact that the charge density is a function that can depend on a number of variables, x, y, z, and time. And here, this will not be an absolute derivative anymore, because you know absolute derivatives mean that this function only depends on one variable. But no, this one actually depends on many variables, and here I want to calculate the derivative with respect to time. In other words, it's don't get confused, because now it's total and now it's partial, you know. Okay? Anyhow, minus the derivative of charge with respect to time can be written as minus the volume integral of the partial derivative of the charge density was two time. Integrated over the whole volume. And now, this is true for any volume that I want to analyze. I have not made any assumptions whatsoever on whether my volume is big, small, spherical, has the shape of a heart, I don't care. And here, same thing. The Gauss theorem is valid for any surface which contains any volume, no matter how big, large, what shape it has, what's the geometry, what's the symmetry, I don't care. Now, if this is true for any volume, and so this is, I can actually then say, all right, then if the charge is increasing here, it's because charge is coming in from the outside. This is the increase of charge in here. This is the amount of charge coming in from the outside. So this has to be equal to that. And then I can write this equation. If this has to be equal to that, and again, this minus sign only takes care of the fact that the increase here means negative flow here, no more than that. And this is true for any volume, whatever, infinite if you want to, I don't care. It can only be possible if what's inside the integral here is identically equal, always, every time, to what's inside this integral. So this equal to that, and you arrive to what we call the continuity equation, which says just one thing. If there is a change of the net amount of charge within a given volume, any volume, it can only happen if there is charge flowing in or out of the volume, as easy as that. And this is why this is called a continuity equation. And by the way, we have actually arrived to this result for a fluid of charge, net charges, going in or out, but this is also true for fluids. At any situation where you have some fluid, whatever particles or in thermodynamics, so, you know, you can also arrive to this, or in statistical physics, when you get to that, it's always true for any system in any kind of whatever, any part of physics, where you have fluids moving in or out. As soon or as far as the number of particles, in this case charge, is conserved, so there is a lot of conservation valid in the system, there will be a continuity equation, which says only that if in a given place the number of particles changes is because particles are flowing in or out. And the net amount of change is related to the net number of lines going in or out. Okay? So that's what we call continuity equation, and we'll use it later. Okay. Now we can finally talk about the Coulomb's law, which is what we're going to do today, talk about this and also the electric field. And again, I'm going to say nothing new. You know the Coulomb's law. Experimentally, the Coulomb's law was determined by Charles Coulomb in the 18th century. Experimentally means that he had no idea what he was doing. So he took a completely, 100% empirical approach to it. They already knew that there was something in nature called charge that made your hair stand up if you were rubbing like your wooden jacket against some whatever amber or whatever. And then, you know, they already saw, or with just pieces of paper, they would attract each other if you rub them against wax, or I don't know what they were using. It's irrelevant. And they already knew that this physical quantity, they didn't understand, but they had observed it was present, had two signs. Same signs sort of repel each other, different signs attract each other. So he started just playing with charges by charging objects, by rubbing and doing like super, super primary things, right? Rubbing twice the time, whatever, right? And he actually came to the realization that this force that would appear between two charged objects could be attractive or repulsive, but it was, well, let's better say, proportional to the product of the net charges and inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them. Okay? And that is what we know today as Coulomb's law. It's a fundamental law of electrostatics. Statics again, very important. We have a situation where we put a few charge objects in static positions, we pin them to each other, I mean to their positions. Interactions take place into each other, I mean between each other, but we don't know how these interactions are since they are pinned. But what Coulomb realized and what we know these days is that if you have, for example, object number one, Q1, and then I put another charge here, any Q, any test Q. This one is pinned, it cannot move. And then I let go of this one, so it can move. It will either be attracted, in other words, move along the line that joins number one and Q, or move away. But he already realized also that the direction of the force was the line that joins the charges, and then it was repulsive or could be repulsive or attractive. Now, that's not new at all. However, very important for the rest of the course, I mean, and the semester and our calculations and our notations, we need a way to actually write both the distance between those two. Let's call them, if you want to, source. Q1 is the one I put first. And test charge, which is the one I put and let go, so it can actually give me information about how things, I mean, what's happening around this Q1. Obviously, Q1 is modifying the space around it. Something, some sort of energy scale appears related to the fact that this little particle is charged. Immediately, emptiness, the hollow space around it, where there was nothing, has something in it, something we cannot see, but charge number two, or the test charge, will fill it and be attracted or repulsed or repelled. So we need a couple of things. First, a way to write the distance between the source and the point where I'm putting my test charge. Second, a way to write the direction that joins those two, because the interaction is linear. I mean, it will take place along this straight line. And third, a sense, either one way or the other on the line. For the same, we need to assign positions. In other words, come up with some reference system, three-dimensional if you want to, X, Y, Z. Assign position vectors to both objects of interest, call R1 the position of my source, call R, if you want to, the position of my test, and immediately I have everything I need, which is a way to actually quantify the distance and also the sense. I have defined the right words or left words, sense on that line. Because if I actually say or realize that the vector going from the source into the test position is just R minus R1, I already have the fact that this distance will be the modulus of the vector, and I have also defined a left and right. Okay. In particular, I can also say that if this is my source, I can call it Q prime, which will see that R prime, and then of course this vector will be r minus r prime. Again, I'm going to use the prime coordinates, or the r1, r2, r3, r4, r5 for the sources, and the r coordinates, the absolute coordinates, to call or to denominate the place in space where I want to calculate or where I want to feel things, quantify. All right? So, if I don't have just one source, q1 or q prime, but I have a number of them, q1, q2, q3, q, whatever, and then I put the test charge somewhere else, for every pair of charges, there will be one Coulomb force appearing, okay? And by the way, since the sense of the r minus r prime vector or r minus r1 vector goes always away from the source, if both charges happen to have the same sign and the interaction is repulsive, the net force will be pointing outwards, in other words, parallel to r minus r prime. If the two charges happen to have different signs and then the interaction is attractive according to Coulomb, then the force will be parallel to minus r minus r prime. And this is what the Coulomb's law says. The force is proportional, I'm talking about this in a moment, to the force between 1 and 2. Q1, r minus r1, modulus square, and then unit vector going along the direction that joins the source with the test. Unit vector means it has a modulus equal to 1, and obviously it can be written as a unit vector along the direction of r minus r prime for whatever r and r prime is going to be something I can write like this. Obviously, the vector over its modulus. So I can write the number q times q1 or prime or whatever over the distance square times the modulus, sorry, the unit vector along that direction as q times q1 or q prime or whatever qk you have there, r minus rk over r minus rk to the third, the cube. Just by putting this into here, and you'll see this very often. If you have more than one test source, in other words, Q1 at R1, Q2 at R2, Q3 at R3, a number of positions will have to be evaluated. Each one of them will generate a force on Q, and the superposition principle holds. You have to sum all of them up to get the net force. Sum them up as vectors, very important, with first, second, and third components. Not just at the intensities of the forces, in other words, the moduli. No. Vectors. Okay? This is going to be very important to keep in mind when we talk about integrals in a moment. Anyhow, this is the Coulomb's law. And important things. Superposition holds. In other words, we have a number of source charges. You have to sum all the small forces on the net, on the position of Q, the test charge, to get the net force. Second, the proportionality constant here in the international system of units, you know, distance in meters and time in seconds and mass in kilos and all that, has a value of 9 times 10 to the 9. Units, I never remember. But then if I want to know what are the units of this, and this has to be a force, the units of this has to go like 1 over Newton, actually have to go like a Newton, sorry, 1 over Coulomb squared times distance squared. So the units of 9, 10 to the 9, 9 times 10 to the 9, are Newton over Coulomb squared, and I need a couple of meters up there, so Newton meter squared over Coulomb squared. I never remember units, but I know how to do this anyhow. Now, in reality, this 9, 10 to the 9 it's a different constant. It's 1/4 pi epsilon naught, which is the dielectric permittivity of the free space. It's a number that is related to the speed of light. As you know, it's a very, very important constant. In the international system, the value of epsilon naught is 85 × 10⁻³ Coulomb square over meter square Newton, which is exactly the inverse units of the thing I just calculated correctly now. Okay? And again, it's related to the speed of light in vacuum. So it's a very, very important thing, and we'll talk more about epsilon naught. But anyway, more important things about the Coulomb force is if we have two particles and number one makes a force equal to F12 on 2, then number two makes a force equal and in different sense of -2 on 1 on 1. Okay, these things you know. Now, why does this actually happen? And as I have already said, the fact is that when you disturb space by introducing some particle, in this case a charge, that is associated with a field, in other words, has something in it, which in this case is charge, that generates some scale of energy, that defines an energy scale around it. In the case of a static charge, it's going to be a potential energy, the electrostatic field, right? Then a second charge or a second object of the same nature that can perceive this disturbance will feel an interaction. In other words, just by existing, charge Q1 or Q prime or whatever you want to call our source charge will affect any other charge around it. Before there was nothing. This is just like the Bible, right? There was nothing and then there was a charge. Okay, then now a second charge will see. So what basically happens is that charges like masses that generate gravity disturb the universe around them. And actually this disturbance in principle reaches infinity. It only goes to zero at infinity. The Coulomb's law goes like the distance squared. It goes to zero at infinity, but in theory, everything else which is near closer than infinity will feel the force generated by this object in principle. For real purposes, actually, you don't need to go as far as infinity to not feel the force anymore, because there will be other things that will dominate. But it's the concept of field, which is always associated with an energy scale, is very important in physics. So we are going to change a little bit our way of thinking, move away from the Coulomb's force, and try to come up with a system where, or at least a language, or a way of understanding things, if you want to say it that way, where interactions are energy scales, and whatever is going to happen next does not depend on the second charge I put there that feels the Coulomb force of the first one, because the first one has already modified and introduced an energy scale in my universe. In other words, the universe is already different just because the first one exists. Can I actually write down how this disturbance takes place regardless of the value of my second charge? Because the universe has already changed, even if I cannot see it because I don't have a second chance and let go of it to see whether it comes closer or more or whatever. Okay, so in order to do this, I am going to introduce the concept of electric field. And then electric potential and potential energy. And this is what we're going to talk about next. And just for you to have the idea, do you know this example about the... Okay, let's do this. I need two people. Two volunteers. Carlos, no? Okay, Carlos and someone else. Venga, what's your name?
Bosco.
Perdón?
Bosco.
Bosco, como el pintor.
Yes.
Muy bien, venga, Carlos y Bosco. Vale. And. Sí, the cameras come here. So everybody can see you and people at home too. All right, so my scarf is going to be the universe. You know this one already? No? All right, then. Bosco, Carlos, you are Atlas, and you are Atlas's friend. The giants that hold the universe on their shoulders. Come here, please. All right? Now, just put some tension on the universe, so the universe is flat. Actually, if you can tilt it, just enough. Okay, so people can see. The universe is flat, but this is just for presentation purposes, okay? So the universe is flat, there is no energy scale, there is nothing happening, it's boring. It's full of beautiful leaves, but anyhow, there's nothing to do with electricity, that's optics, okay? Well, actually, optics is also electromagnetism, but you'll learn that later. Anyway, so imagine this is my charge. Here I have a test charge. Source is the source. Am I going to put a source in my universe? Bueno, don't keep it just a bit more flat, just like okay. Immediately, the fact that I put a particle that is associated with some sort of interaction, an energy scale is defined in the system, and in this particular case, a potential well, a well appears, a hole. Okay? I have no way of knowing how intense the energy scale is unless I put a second object. Imagine this piece of chalk is my test charge. I'm gonna put it nearby. For example, here, actually you can tilt it a bit, not that way, the other way. Right. Okay? And let go of it. And what's going to happen? Oh no. Actually, excuse my French, but you know that in physics shit happens, right? So that was shit. But it's just because the interaction was too strong and the object went past. It acquired too much velocity, too much acceleration, too much energy. But it was, I'll put it closer. Okay? Or maybe use something heavier. Now this is good. Let's do it again. Anyhow, I put my charge here and it goes, whoa, boom, to the minimum of energy. One thing that is common to pretty much any problem in physics, regardless whether energies are conservative or forces, is that everybody, not just you, and by you I also mean me, okay? We all want to go to our minimum of energy. I mean, it's nature is like this, okay? And so do charges. So if someone is generating an energy scale that produces minima, even if they are just local, a second someone will fill it and go to the minimum. This is independent of what is the value of the, in this case, charge associated with our second object. Charge number one has already disturbed the space around it. The universe is already different just because charge number one exists. So now what we're going to do is actually write down a way to actually quantify this disturbance and also the energy scale associated with it so we can calculate how intense will be these interactions. Okay, thank you very much. You did very well. Okay. Okay? So this is what we're gonna do now and talk about the concept of electric. And in order to make life easy, we are going to define the electric field around any given source of field, in other words, a charge, or a distribution of charge, I don't think it does need to be finite, as the force. And by force, I mean the net Coulomb force that a charge, meaning test charge, my chalk, equal to 1 Coulomb would say. As easy as that. Make Q test charge equal to 1. Put that in the Coulomb force. What's left is what we're going to call electric field. So, by definition, the electric field is just the net Coulomb force that my distribution of sources, be it 1, be it n, be it a finite body, would generate on a test charge equal to 1, obviously located in some position, and it will not be the same if it's very close or it's very far. Our chalk was actually filling a very, you know, whatever, it's not the same if I put the charge, the second charge here, there, whatever. Well, actually, the example is a bit misleading for many reasons, but we don't want to go into that. This is how we are going to define the electric field of a distribution of point charges Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, located and pinned, in other words, static, at L1 or 2 or 3 or 4, on a given position R. When I can put a test charge Q equal to 1, I just put nothing. Okay? And in fact, if you have a frame of reference, because we need to write down the magnitudes, the quantities associated with those vectors. And I have my test charge number 1, Q1, and R1. Test charge number 2, Q2, some arbitrary position R2. Number 3, whatever, 4, 5, up, Qn, and Rn. And I want to, obviously, each one of those is going to generate something around it. And I want to calculate the net effect of all of those in a given position, arbitrary R, where I can put the test charge Q to measure the force on it, because I can measure forces. I can put it in a dynamometer or whatever. Or just put nothing. Put a Q equal to 1 if you want to. And then what I need to make sure is that if the superposition principle holds for the Coulomb equation, it also holds for the electric field definition. On this place, on this position, this very position, an electric field will appear because of Q1 that will depend on the distance from Q1 to R1, to the R. Come back to life, please. Yes, good. Of course, then, there will also be a field generated by 2 that will depend on the position to 2 and to nothing else. R minus R2 vector. And then, same goes for every other test. R minus Rn here will generate the field. Now I have to sum all of those vectorially, that's fine. And I will get a net field in that position. Since to define the field, I actually took the value of Q out of the equation, I have now a way of actually measuring the intensity of a possible Coulomb force located, if I put the charge here, regardless of the value of that charge. Okay? And the field, the value of the field, is potential force, meaning possible force, but not realized until I put the test actual charge in there, will actually not depend on the value of Q, just on the sources and the positions, the relative positions between every source and the place where I want to measure things. Okay? And again, physically, only represents the Coulomb force on the test charge equal to 1 in that position. Now, important thing. Since the superposition principle holds, this is a, I can sort of do this and draw this for a set, a discrete set of point charges. But more often than not, and luckily for you, we're going to have finite objects, continuous charge distributions, like a charge sphere or a line or whatever. How can we calculate the electric field around a continuous object? In other words, how does a sphere charged with a total charge equal to Q evenly distributed over the whole sphere, what does it do to the universe around it? Well, it does something. Instead of thinking of point charges, source charges, let's think of them as differential, tiny, tiny, tiny pieces of charge inside a body. Imagine a potato, like we were talking about yesterday. Let's have a potato. Let's assume there is a charge density distributed inside the potato. It can be uniform or no, who cares? We can actually define the charge density as something that depends on the position. We are going to call position inside the source, in this case, R prime. And in every differential volume, there will be a differential charge, dq prime. Well, in this case, if I actually want to calculate the electric field in some position, for example, here, R, any R, then what I need to do is keep into mind that the field here will depend from the distance to my dq. In other words, we'll have to go along this direction, downwards or out of here, upwards, but in this direction, so in the direction of R minus R prime. There will be a small, a very small differential electric field generated at R because of my differential field at R prime. If I want to know the net field in that position, what I need to do is calculate my differential field from here, super tiny one, and then go to the next place, super tiny one, next place, super tiny one. Every little differential field sitting in every different differential volume will generate one differential field, and they will point in different directions because each one of them will point in the actual R minus R prime direction for that place. Now, if I sum all of them, I do the integral over the whole volume, triple integral extended to the whole V prime. This is how we will write the expressions to calculate electric fields for continuous charge distributions. Well, in my case, for three dimensions, differential field is rho dV. Remember yesterday how do we define the charge density? And that is the way to actually write fields for continuous charge distributions, and now I have to calculate integrals. And see, I mean, this is a theory, but now how do I write R? How do I write R prime? How do I do all of this? That we will see. In two dimensions, my dQ is sigma dS. In one dimension, my dQ is lambda dL, like we saw yesterday. And obviously, in these cases, the integral will be double, meaning extended to the surface. In the case of one-dimensional charge distributions, the integral will be single extended to a line. Can be straight or not. How do we do this? Well, we'll do it. But the important thing to keep in mind is that the electrostatic field symmetry resulting around or near any body where there is some distribution of charge distributed in a region will be determined by the geometry of the sources. Okay? This object, this object, and this object. And Gaussian, both in the Coulomb force, in the electrostatic field definition, and in these definitions, when you replace the values of the charges or the charge densities, you have to use the signs. If a charge is negative, put it with a minus sign. If two charges are negative, minus times minus equals plus. Okay, good. This minus relative sign, if present, is what's going to change the direction of this vector, which is what basically tells me whether this field points upwards or inwards. It's important. One last thing, and then we go. That we'll do tomorrow. Let me stop sharing and just give you one example of visualization for a line, so you just go home with a very clear idea of what I mean. Maybe you know this website. Have you know this? No? Okay. Well, it's just from the MIT. They have wonderful electrostatic. I want to make this big. Simulations, and let me share for people at home. And that's it. It's real quick. Huh? Window. This one. Share. Okay. How would we calculate? Just for you to understand what these integrals mean. Imagine we have a line, straight line, a one-dimensional charge distribution with some charge evenly distributed, so a let's say constant lambda. Meaning I can divide my object, my source, in this case a line, into small dls. This one, this one, this one, this one, this one, this one, this one. Each one of them has a dq, small charge in it. And I want to calculate the field, for example, here. Every little dq, for example, that one, will generate a small DE, small field, in this place. This one is this small arrow. This one, the next one. This one, the next one. This one, that one here, that tiny arrow pointing upwards. And then when I move and I scan R prime over the whole line, R minus R prime, which is this vector in red here, changes. But R, which is the point where I'm calculating, stays constant. And then if I sum vectorially, like vectors, all of these tiny electric fields, this big arrow, the red one here, is the result, the superposition, the net field, which has ways. Okay? So when I actually go and scan R prime over the whole length of my body, the resulting field here is just the sum of all these time fields, and then you get that. So that's what we do with the integrals. Move r prime, keep r constant, and change the distance, I mean, between every little charge and the place where I want to calculate by scanning r prime over my whole body. And this is what we will do in examples, okay? Tomorrow. All right, then. That's it. And we'll keep working about it tomorrow.